Welcome to Making Change Radio. I'm your host, Catherine Reed, and tonight we're going to be talking about gun violence prevention. Joining me on this show is J.P. Thomas. He is the program manager at Brady, and Kevin Bergen, who has been a gun violence prevention activist for 5.5 years here locally. Welcome, gentlemen. Thank you both so much for being here.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
So I'm interested to know what your journey has been to gun violence prevention activism. I'd like to start, JP, with a little bit of your background, how you ended up at Brady. And for our listeners who maybe are not aware of the genesis of the Brady campaign and your recent rebranding to Brady United, give us some background about this particular organization.
Great. Yeah, I'll start with the history of Brady. Brady was an organization created early on during the 80s, and it was originally called Handgun Inc. And the reason why Brady was created was because in 1981, Jim Brady, who was the press secretary for President Ronald Reagan, was shot here in Washington, D.C., when an assassin, John Hinckley Jr., tried to kill President Ronald Reagan here in D.C. at a hotel you may know up in DuPont Circle. And because of that, Jim Brady was rushed to George Washington Hospital, and he was believed to be dead. He was announced on national television to be dead, but in fact, he survived the shooting. And because of that shooting and because of the gun that was used to shoot Press Secretary Jim Brady, the organization was created. And it was created not only by Jim Brady, but most importantly, I'd say, by Sarah Brady, who was Jim Brady's wife. She was an incredible advocate for gun violence prevention. And because of the work that was done by Jim and Sarah Brady, the Brady Bill was passed and signed by President Bill Clinton. And that was actually what created the background check system that we have here in the United States of America. So Brady is actually the gun in D.C. is the longest gun violence prevention organization that's existed. And I was lucky enough to join Brady actually after I was an organizer here in Northern Virginia. I was an organizer here during the 2018 midterms in Loudoun County, and I started organizing right before the Parkland shooting. And when I was organizing during the Democratic primary, gun violence prevention became the most important issue here in Northern Virginia. And that was because of all these students from Parkland all the way up here to Fairfax who really wanted to talk about gun violence prevention and wanted to see a stop to the school shootings that were happening, the impacted communities that were feeling gun violence every single day. And on the campaign that I was working on, so many students came and said, we want to talk about gun violence prevention and we want our elected officials here in Virginia to make sure that they address it, both at the congressional level and also in Richmond. So it was an issue that because of my work here in Virginia and because of the Parkland shooting, I actually got involved with Brady. And ever since I've been organizing with Brady, one of the most important experiences that I've had there was during the special session, which happened on July 9th in Virginia, where after the Virginia Beach shooting, Governor Northam called back the legislators and there was no vote on any gun violence prevention bills. And Republicans called off the session in only 90 minutes. So that's a little bit about my story and how I got involved with gun violence prevention.
Well, I'm going to interject here for people who were not aware of that July 9th special session. I'll just give a little bit of background about the fact that Virginia only has a part-time legislature, and it meets for either 45 days or 60 days per year from January to March. And in that time, thousands, literally thousands of bills are put in front of committees to decide whether or not they'll get a floor vote. And because both chambers are controlled by Republicans, committee assignments are made by the Speaker of the House in the House of Delegates, which means that some of these bills, most of these bills, never get a floor vote because they're killed in committee. And so you have to understand the structure of the legislature to understand why it is so hard to get anything passed in Virginia is simply because the process is skewed to the party in power. And I will remind you more than once tonight that the best way to be an activist is to use your vote as your voice. Everybody's focused on 2020. The fact of the matter is we need to be focused on November 5th, 2019. Because in an off-year election, 30% of voters in Virginia decide who's going to be the sheriffs, the Commonwealth's attorneys, the senators, the delegates, who's on the board of supervisors, and who's on the school boards. 30% of the voters decide who is going to hold all those offices. So I want to remind our listeners that if you want to be involved in gun prevention activism, start with registering to vote and showing up at the polls. I want to talk a little bit with Kevin Bergen, who is no stranger to guns because of his background and experience in the military, and also as a probation and parole officer. And so I'm kind of interested, as a person who has handled guns as part of your career, how you came to be an activist for gun violence prevention, Kevin.
Well, it's interesting that you describe the committee process and how bills die in the legislature, because that's how I got into the prevention of gun violence business. I read in the Washington Post an editorial about a bill that Senator Barbara Favola had advanced, and it passed in the Senate 28 to 6 to 5, and one abstention, whatever adds up to 40. And so there was obviously across the aisle support. Both sides were in favor of this bill because it was going to make a felony out of things like stalking, sexual stalking, domestic violence. And with that felony conviction, if the individual was convicted, they would give up their gun. And that all made good sense to me. So in the middle of the editorial, it said that the bill then went from the Senate with its bipartisan support over to the House of Delegates, where it was promptly killed. They had expert witnesses there who were not called. They were there to speak in favor of the bill. There were probably victims there. I know there have been in other hearings that I've attended who would have given just absolutely gut-wrenching testimony about stalking. None of them were called, and the vote was not recorded. And I thought, wait a minute, this is not the government that I thought I was serving for 28 years in the Air Force and 15 years in the Department of Corrections. What in the hell is going on here? So I called down to the chairman's office and was told by the person who answered the phone that they couldn't comment to me. They weren't cleared to talk about legislative matters. So I sent an email to him and got no reply. So I sent an email to every member of that committee, and after about 6 weeks, I got one answer that basically said, Mr. Bergen, what you don't understand is this is where gun bills are sent to die. And I said, okay, I'm all in. And
That's a great story, Kevin. For those of you who are joining us, this is Making Change Radio. And the two change makers I'm talking with tonight are J.P. Thomas of Brady and Kevin Bergen, both of them committed, passionate activists for gun violence prevention. You know, the legislative process clearly is broken, not just in Virginia, but all across the country. And I think what people are asking themselves is, why can't we get anything done? It's one mass shooting after another. Are we getting numb to it, gentlemen? Driving over here tonight, I was listening about the city of Philadelphia struggling with the 6 policemen who were shot. And then I get here, and JP tells me that there's been another shooting in Philadelphia. I mean, you can barely wrap your mind around one shooting in El Paso, followed immediately by one in Dayton, and immediately by Philadelphia, and then immediately by something else. I mean, it's like, how do we wrap our arms around something that's clearly a crisis, and yet we do not speak of it in a way that says, if there's a crisis, we need to address what to do about the crisis. It seems to always come back to Second Amendment rights and who has the right to own assault weapons. JP?
It's a really interesting question, and I think that this country is not numb to the problem of gun violence, and I've seen, just as I've been in the movement for a year, how things are changing, particularly in the midterms in 2018, for example. We saw gun violence prevention champions win at the grassroots level across this country. Here, even in Virginia 10, in the district that I worked in, we saw Jennifer Wexton defeat a Republican, Barbara Comstock, and really show, because a backgrounds check bill was passed through the House, a Charleston loophole bill was passed through the House, that grassroots activism on gun violence prevention can create change. We just need people to stand up and be willing to talk to their elected officials, to get out there and vote, to knock on doors and talk to people about these issues. And I think that we will see change if we stick to it and we aren't willing to kind of sit back and say, people are numb to this. We're never going to solve this problem. And I think that this year in Virginia, most importantly, Virginia can be a bellwether for the entire country on gun violence prevention. Because both the state Senate and the House of Delegates are decided by one vote. And we, if we're able to come out as gun violence prevention activists, as people who are regular community members who care about this issue, and get out and look at the candidates that are in Virginia right now, do your research, look at their websites, who's talking about gun violence in your community and who's not. And try to stand up and work with those candidates, because we can pass a lot of really good legislation in Virginia if gun violence prevention champions win on November 5th. So if you look at the governor's package that he put forward during the special session, there's an assault weapons ban, there's universal background checks, there's one handgun a month. There is closing the boyfriend and stalking loophole so that they can't get guns. And there's a ton of solutions that we can really use to address gun violence in Virginia if we make change right now. And as someone who's also worked in voting rights, gun violence prevention in Virginia will be impacted so much even more by this election, because this is the election that decides how the maps are made in Virginia, and how the districts are created and how fair they'll be. And that is really important to issues, not even like gun violence prevention, but other civil rights issues that we care about, other voting rights issues that people really deeply care about. This election decides a lot of that. So I don't think that people are becoming numb to this issue, because even in the year that I've been involved in the movement, I've seen so much good work, both at the state level, at the congressional level, and even at these presidential debates. You're seeing people talk about the issues in a really good way. If you look at Elizabeth Warren's plan, Kamala Harris's plan, Cory Booker's plan, they're all looking at the public health problem of gun violence prevention, and they want to address it. So they're, the change makers are there. We just need to be out there and supporting them and giving them the tools they need to get into office.
So Kevin, you know, talk a little bit about, you know, the CDC and the fact that we don't have accurate numbers on even how widespread I think JP said they're using 100 deaths a day now. You know, usually I say it's about 95 deaths a day from guns, and about 10 of those are children. Mm-hmm. But we actually, the CDC is prohibited from studying it. Agencies are prohibited from collecting data on it. You know, there's so many prohibitions around anything having to do with guns. You know, talk a little bit about how in activism you can, like, try to take stabs at something when you are grasping it, trying to put solid science and data behind how massive the problem is.
Well, I think that picture that you just painted is changing. I really do. I'm seeing the needle move. Interestingly, the legislator, the gentleman who wrote the legislation, which put in the prohibition for putting money into a bill to look at gun violence, came out, I'm going to say now it's maybe coming up on a year, and he admitted that he made a mistake. He said, I should have never done that. That was wrong. We need to have good data. And he's the one that got it put into the bill, and he acknowledges that he made a mistake. But if I could just go back to the discussion we've been having about voting and knocking on doors and the election, you can be an activist tomorrow, okay? You can be an activist writing postcards. I have a whole bunch of shirts that I wear, and I walk every day. And I get comments about these shirts, and they all have to do with guns and gun violence and Brady. And the comments are 90% positive. So you can interact with people on a daily basis. You can feel them out. You can talk to them, educate them on the subject of gun violence. You can tell them that we can't study it. You know, the doctors were told by the NRA or an NRA spokesperson or a person who feels the way the NRA and the NRA spokesperson feels to stay in their own damn lane. And I'm telling you, those doctors came back out and let them have it. And they said, this is our lane. This is a public health crisis. Stay the hell away from us while we're working in our lane. So it doesn't have to wait until November. It doesn't have to wait until an election. It doesn't have to be national. It can be the alderman in your little district. It can be your representative to the House of Delegates. You could bring up these things that we're talking about tonight and ask them, you know, what's your feeling on this? Something that would really upset you. It did me. I hope it would you as well. When you ask somebody about gun violence and tell them the way the landscape is and things can't get done and this is the way it is, and they say, well, why is it that way? Why won't they approve these bills? They seem to make sense to me. And then you say, who's your delegate? Who's your representative? And they say,
I don't know. I know, right? So it's hard to press in a democracy. It's hard to press your advantage by saying, I'm your constituent and I care about this issue, if you don't know who to email, write, call, or show up to their office. You make an excellent point, Kevin. For those of us just joining, this is Making Change Radio. I'm your host, Catherine Reed, and joining me is J.P. Thomas of Brady and Kevin Bergen, both of them gun violence prevention advocates here on Radio Fairfax. So let's talk a little bit about the fact that the NRA headquarters is actually right here in Fairfax. And, you know, and there are protests on the 14th of every month to mark the Sandy Hook shooting, which was on the 14th of December. The 14th of every month, people can go outside the NRA headquarters. And to your point, Kevin, showing up is 90% of it. You know, wearing a T-shirt or having a bumper sticker or indicating to people who meet you casually or in the course of their daily business to know that you are prepared to speak about gun violence prevention.
On the line in Safeway. You know, it's backed up. The cash register ran out of paper tape, and so you're stuck there, and the person behind you makes a comment about your shirt, and you turn around, and you're in a conversation, and you're educating. I mean, it's really simple. It's really simple.
Well, it's very divisive, and, you know, and I think it's very perplexing that it's gotten to the point where it's a political issue instead of a safety issue or a public health issue. Why is this a Republican versus Democrat issue? Both Republicans and Democrats are dying in record numbers every day. But lobbyists, special interest groups, it's been problematic in this country for a long time, the amount of money involved in campaigns. Dark money, Citizens United, where is the money even coming from? But the fact that organizations like the NRA wield so much power over people who have accepted their money. You know, how do we get around that in trying to take down an organization that clearly, and it's not just the elected officials either, you know, it's the rank and file out there who truly believe that the NRA represents them. And it hasn't for years. Most of the original members of the NRA were there for gun safety reasons. You know, they used to do gun safety classes. A lot of them were hunters, as a matter of fact. It seems to me that the whole focus of that organization has changed. How do we push back?
Well, so at Brady, we're very lucky that we have a whole community of gun violence prevention organizations. There's a coalition built with March for Our Lives, Giffords, Everytown. And if you look at the work that all these different groups are doing around the country, they are standing up to the NRA. And we are standing up to that dark money that the NRA is pushing. And if you look at the 2018 midterms, gun violence prevention organizations spent more money than the NRA. And that's the first time that that has ever happened in history. And the way that we really look at trying to make sure that there's transparency in our government is to show folks how much money their politicians have gotten from the NRA. So if you look at the biggest donor to Donald Trump's campaign in 2016 was the NRA. And they donated tens of millions of dollars, some of that money actually even coming from Russia. And many folks have heard about the Maria Butina story and her and the Russian government's connections with the NRA. But we need to make sure that we're lifting these stories and making people see the impact that this dark money has on our politics, not only at the federal level, but at state levels too. If you go through the VPAP website, vpap.org, which is a great website to see who's donating to which candidates, the NRA has donated to almost every member in the Senate, state Senate and the House of Delegates that is supporting their agenda. And they've given a lot of money over the years, and it has a huge impact, particularly in smaller races. But we think that by coming together and donating to gun violence prevention organizations, making sure that they have the ability to stand up for the voice that hasn't been heard for a while is so important. And secondly, we also talk about democracy issues are gun violence prevention issues. If folks from impacted communities of gun violence don't have the ability to vote, that is a gun violence prevention issue. If there are, right now, we just at Brady got into a campaign called 51 for 51 that's pushing for DC statehood so that we can make sure that those close to a million people in the District of Columbia have those senators who can stand up and say, our citizens are impacted by gun violence and we need a democracy that will address their problems. So we try to be as intersectional as a movement as we can, team up with as many important issues as we can so that we can not only address gun violence, but address the problems with our democracy that the NRA has been able to use for their advantage for the last 15, 20 years.
Well, you make a really good point about the fact that, you know, NRA money is in local elections, and there's a reason for that. You know, we did have a one handgun a month bill that was repealed. So it's back to the drawing board. And this is the problem when the control of the chamber, either chamber, both chambers, change. Suddenly, because a lot of the guns, and I don't know if our listeners are aware of this, but a lot of the guns that are committing crimes in New York are coming from Virginia. We are the source of so many guns that leave this state. And again, there's just so many guns in this country. We were talking about this actually before we went on the air, the fact that we don't even know how many guns there are in this country. You know, you think that because there's no national registry of guns, the fact that they're taken during the commission of crimes, people's houses are broken into, guns are taken, They're floating around. And one of the two of you gave me the statistic that it's estimated about 5% of the people in this country own 95% of the guns. Is that accurate? Or is that just a good guess?
Yeah, I can't cite, excuse me, I can't cite a specific reference for that, but it could be that I'm mixing up what we call bad apple gun dealers. These are the ones that the authorities know sell guns illegally. They don't do the background checks. They'll approve straw purchases, and there are just a handful of bad apple gun dealers.
And I want you to hold that thought till we get back from this break. Join us afterwards. We're talking about gun violence prevention.
Facts.
You once, twice, three times a lady.
Hi, this is Trey Boucher with Morning Mix, where you'll hear us every Friday from 8 until 11, playing all of your favorite songs back from the 40s right on up to the present. We're going to play things that you remember, some new things that you're going to love, every Friday morning from 8 until 11 on Radio Fairfax.
The laughs never stop in Papa's basement. I'm telling you, every week Papa shares some of his comedy, as well as the Northern Virginia experience. Papa's Basement, Monday night at 11 on Radio Fairfax.
Greetings, astral travelers. It's time to get beamed up for Aurora Borealis. Experimental transmissions and otherworldly frequencies to boggle your brain and transform your inner being. Enjoy a smorgasbord of noise, ambient, electronica, indie, world, and neo-psychedelia, featuring selections from tape, vinyl, CDs, and digital files, out of my own library and out of obligation to my alien earworm overlords. Aurora Borealis, Thursdays at 10 p.m. right here on Radio Fairfax.
Welcome to Isla Earth. What is green and gold and red all over? Give up? It's Southern California's Santa Monica Public Library. Allow me to explain. Like many cities with aging public buildings, Santa Monica knew its library badly needed new digs. But before breaking ground, the city committed to construction that follows Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design, or LEED guidelines, administered by the U.S. Green Building Council. The city tucked underground three levels of parking and a 200,000-gallon rainwater cistern that irrigates the library's sustainable landscaping. Inside, an open design provides natural lighting. And topping things off, rooftop solar electric panels generate renewable energy for the building. As cool as this sounds, there's also a real cost savings. Encouraging policies in your community that incorporate green ideas can cut energy usage between 30 to 70% for a building. And if that's not enough of a reason, the Commission for Environmental Cooperation recently reported that buildings are responsible for over a third of the continent's carbon emissions. A good reason for all of us to support LEED standards for new buildings. Learn more at islaearth.org. But if you're looking us up in your public library, shh, people are reading. Isla Earth is recorded on the campus of California State University, San Bernardino, and produced by the Catalina Island Conservancy, because Earth is an island.
This is Radio Fairfax, original non-commercial programming by Fairfax County volunteers. Come join us and put on your own show. Learn how on the web at fcac.org/orientation.
We're not just another radio station.
Well, yeah, we are.
Welcome back to Making Change Radio. I'm your host, Catherine Reed, and tonight we're talking about gun violence prevention with two change makers who are passionate activists and advocates for gun violence prevention. Welcome back, J.P. Thomas of Brady and Kevin Bergen. I have a question I want to ask you. Each of you is working on very specific programs. So we've talked a little bit about the organizations. Now there are specific programs, there are specific events coming up. You know, we haven't really talked about assault weapons versus other kinds of gun violence. You know, so much has been talked about AK-47s and AR-15s, and these need to be banned, which I agree. Nobody needs those guns. They're not shooting deers with those guns or bunny rabbits or squirrels or something. But with so much focus on we should pass legislation about assault rifles, I think we're missing the point that a lot of gun violence is not assault rifles. Those are maybe mass shootings. But let's talk a little about the End Family Fire program, Kevin, and the many everyday instances in which gun violence takes lives that are not mass shootings.
Okay. End Family Fire actually got its start with a program called ASK, which is simply the acronym for Asking Saves Kids. So you're responsible for a child. You're the parent, you're the grandparent, you're the babysitter, you're the nanny, you're the teenage babysitter. The child is going to a house that they have not visited before. And you've been told that you need to find out some information before you allow the child to go. So you might practice, because this might seem a little uncomfortable to you. Because when you dial the home number where your child maybe, is going, you say, please don't take offense, but are there any unsecured firearms in your house? You're asking. You know, you ask about peanut allergies. You tell the parent at the home where they're going that your child is afraid of big dogs. Do you have a big dog? Well, how about, are there any unsecured firearms in your home? So that's the ASK program, and that's what I started with. I think they gave it to me because it was easy when I started, and I didn't perceive that there would be any blowback. I mean, who could be opposed to making sure that the home where you're sending your child is safe for your child to go and play, or to the pool party, or to the sleepover? So it's very simple. It's very straightforward. Are there any unsecured firearms in your home? If the answer is yes, or they take offense, well come on to our house. Come on, send your daughter over here to our house. We can, you know, be the host family for this time. So the ASK program then morphed into End Family Fire, and I'll turn that over to JP. That's the latest version of ASK is now End Family Fire. Now we're asking the gun owner, not the homeowner, but the gun owner, to help us end family fire.
Thanks, Kevin. The way that we have been talking about it at Brady is that asking, as Kevin mentioned, is a solution to ending family fire. So the next question is, what's family fire? And a family fire incident is when an unsecured gun is left around the home and leads to an unintentional shooting. And oftentimes that happens with children. With the statistics that our organization have found and developed is that there are 8 children and teens a day are shot because a gun is left unsecured in the home. And that is what we call an end family fire incident. And in addition to children who are accidentally, and we actually use the term unintentional because we don't like using the term accident, because oftentimes this is a very much a preventable problem in people's lives. When guns are unsecured in the home, they also can cause people to use them against themselves in a situation where they decide to turn the guns on themselves. And if you look at a lot of the mass shootings, including Parkland and many others in our country, they oftentimes happen because parents leave guns unsecured in the home, and children are able to get them and then use them in their schools as well. So just by doing the simple thing that Kevin mentioned and asking really makes people think about, I need to secure my gun in my home with a gun safe or a trigger lock. I need to make sure my ammunition is actually held separately from my gun so that it can't accidentally go off. and that it's in a secure place where it isn't easy to get to by a child in your home. And I've had so many conversations with gun owners, and you mentioned earlier the rebrand of Brady. Our new tagline is Take Action, Not Sides. And our mission is to talk to gun owners and non-gun owners alike to try to prevent this public health epidemic that is gun violence. So we're, by using the End Family Fire program, we're putting out PSAs all across the country. You actually probably see them a lot of times here on Fairfax Public Access. And the End Family Fire PSAs make people think about, I need to be safer with my family. And even if I don't have children in my home, if my grandkids are going to come into my home or my nephews and nieces, I need to make sure that they're safe. So we are really trying to make sure that we are not trying to be a Republican or a Democratic organization. We're trying to save lives. Our mission is to decrease gun violence by 25% by 2025. So we want to go out there, reach and talk to gun owners, figure out how we can best save gun lives lost to gun violence in America. Because right now, every year, 40,000 lives are lost due to gun violence. And that is one of the highest causes of deaths in the entire country. In Virginia, there are more deaths due to gun violence than there are to car accidents. It's more than 1,000 people dying to gun violence every year. So it's such a complex issue, but there are some great programs that we have at Brady and that other gun violence prevention organizations have, such as the Ask Campaign, such as End Family Fire, that are looking at reaching gun owners and not telling them, we want to take all your guns away, but we want you to use guns in a safe way so that community members can feel safe and don't have to worry about walking to school every day and don't have to worry about their morning routine, including what are you going to do when there's a lockdown drill or what are you going to wear to school to make sure you're safe? So it's such a complex issue, but there are a lot of programs out there that can help save lives.
And I think raising the visibility of impact. So on August 11th, not all people get like a paper newspaper anymore, but some of us still get the paper Washington Post delivered on the doorstep every day. And in the August 11th paper, there was an insert that was 12 pages of the mass shootings going back to 1966. And the number of people who have lost their lives due to gun violence. You know, I think a lot of people were probably surprised, not by the number of people in their pictures, but by the fact that the date 1966 is how they pegged mass shootings. For those who are just joining us, this is Making Change Radio. I'm your host, Catherine Reed, and we're talking about gun violence prevention with J.P. Thomas and Kevin Bergen. And again, you know, helping people to visualize, to understand, to grasp the enormity of this. Talk about the fact that if we've had mass shootings since 1966 and the government has actively prohibited us from studying or collecting the data and information, how has that impacted our ability now to say to the public, this is larger than the men that we've sent to war? I mean, we've lost more American citizens in a non-combat situation than we've lost people who signed up to serve overseas in combat.
Mm-hmm. And it's one of the first problems we have here is that we don't have the data, and it's hard to come up with solutions to problems when you don't fully know the scope of the problem. And because of the Dickey Amendment, which has now kind of been lessened, and the Dickey Amendment, to give folks an understanding, was an amendment put on by a representative who Kevin mentioned earlier that didn't allow the CDC or the NIH to quote unquote advocate for gun safety or for gun control. And this made it so that the CDC and the NIH was afraid to do any type of research at all on gun violence because they were afraid that it would be stopped by the Dickey Amendment. Luckily now, this year, and the first time in a very, very long time, the House of Representatives has allocated $50 million for the study of gun violence prevention. $25 million for the CDC, $25 million for the NIH. And it's an incredible win for the House of Representatives, but now that's stalled in the Senate. And the United States Senate has not only stalled research, and Mitch McConnell particularly has not only stalled that type of research, and that research isn't only looking at number of deaths. It's right now in the United States, we don't know how many people are shot by guns a year. We don't know how many people are going into our hospitals because the CDC doesn't have a good track record to say, oh, this is our how many deaths there are, which they're able to use death records to do. But it's a lot harder for them to say these are how many people are shot every year. And if you look at their guesstimations, it's about a 40,000 person range, which is unbelievable. So that type of research needs to be done so that we can come up with solutions to stop this type of violence. And we need the Senate to pass the package that the House has already passed so that we can have research both in the CDC and in the NIH so we can know the scope of this problem and we can begin looking at those solutions. And I want to say a little bit more about the Senate because right now after the El Paso and Dayton shootings, there has been gun violence prevention organizations such as Brady has called Mitch McConnell to bring the senators back from recess to vote on universal background checks, on extreme risk laws, on an assault weapons ban. And we're asking them to take these votes and come back, but they have not done so. There's been a lot of words from McConnell, a lot of words from President Donald Trump, but we haven't seen any action.
And this mirrors what happened in Virginia. You know, so we have a part-time legislature. They're done either the last week of February or the first week of March, but they can be called back. And so the governor did that, but he does not call the shots. The Speaker of the House and the Senate Majority Leader do. And so in this case, Mitch McConnell could call these congressional representatives back from their August recess. He has the power to do that. Refuses to do that. So, you know, we're being stopped at every turn, stymied at every turn. And Kevin, tell us a little bit about how people can show up every day, you know, to bring pressure to bear. And what are those pressure points? How can people really, as a course of their daily routine, do something about this issue?
Well, I think you get opportunities every day. I just had a letter to the editor published today. I was answering a letter. You can initiate a letter on your own, you know, write to the newspaper with your strong, well-expressed feelings on preventing gun violence, or you can respond to someone who already has a letter published in the newspaper. That's what I did in this case. It was a gentleman who wanted to say that prevention of gun violence measures was a slippery slope. We used to call that the nose of the camel in the tent in the Air Force, meaning that the camel gets his nose in the tent and you need to be concerned because pretty soon the whole camel is going to be in the tent. Well, that's their view of a slippery slope. You can't give in on one gun bill because what are they going to want next? And so he had a letter in the Alexandria Gazette on this slippery slope. And he helped me a great deal because he was making an analogy to cars. Alexandria is taking some cars off the road, as he sees it, by putting in bike lanes. And so I just turned that around and said, well, let's talk about cars and slippery slope. I don't know if you're old enough to remember, but there was a big brouhaha about seat belts. The manufacturers didn't want to go to the expense and the motorists didn't want to use them. And then you talk about backup cameras. Well, now that's all, you know, people are all on board with seat belts and backup cameras and love them and use them. And if you take that analogy a little further, you're driving a car. It's got to be insured. It's got to be licensed. It's got to be inspected. You know, don't be afraid of things that make common sense. You know, let's pass some of these common sense gun legislations. We don't want to be the Iron Highway, which is what Virginia is known as for its stretch of 95 to get all those guns up to New York, New Jersey, Connecticut, Rhode Island, Delaware that you were talking about before. They go right up 95, and we're the Iron Highway. Let's get that one gun a month bill back in effect. And, you know, I don't see that as a slippery slope. When an overwhelming majority of people want something, I don't see that that's a slippery slope. So be involved, you know, write letters, make phone calls, engage the people that you see on the street on this issue, talk to them, bring them along, educate them. On the end family fire, there are a number of gun owners who will say, you know, my kids don't know where the guns are.
Oh, yes, they do. And they play with them, by the way. And absolutely. I can speak from personal experience,
absolutely,
having grown up with guns in my home.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's true. They know where they are, and they've had them in their hand.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we have a statistic that we use. It's 1 in 5 children have handled a gun without their parents knowing.
In fact, they prefer it that way. I can just tell you.
Yeah.
I grew up in rural Southwest Virginia. There were hunting. There were my father had guns in a gun case. The ammunition was in a cabinet below the gun case, and the key to the gun case was on the mantle. Hello. And so, you know, of course we handled those shotguns and those rifles. They weren't AR-15s. They weren't AKA-47s, you know, and it was just a normal part of growing up in a rural part of the state. You know, people's almost every home you went into had guns in them. But we didn't have the kind of shootings, accidental or otherwise, at least not to my knowledge, that we have now. And you have to ask yourself, what is the difference? If you're just joining us, this is Making Change Radio here on Radio Fairfax. My guests talking about gun violence prevention are J.P. Thomas of Brady and Kevin Bergen, a longtime activist. And we are really talking about what we can all do. We can all do a little bit more. We can all make it a point to talk to everyone we meet about the fact that this is the greatest threat to public safety, to public health, is guns and gun violence. And the fact that walking into any place, it doesn't matter if it's the grocery store, it doesn't matter if it's your church, people who have a concealed carry permit could have a loaded gun in their pocket, in their jacket, strapped to their ankle, or in their purse. And none of us know that. This is the culture we live in. And we think it's normal because this is what the culture we live in, but it is an anomaly for the entire rest of the developed world. They think we are the crazy ones. So tell me, JP, what is the upcoming recess rally all about? It's this weekend.
So I have a bunch of calls to action for folks in Virginia and beyond. But one important one focuses on what I was speaking about earlier regarding making sure the Senate calls back its members in order to vote on gun violence prevention measures. So we, Brady, and a bunch of other gun violence prevention groups such as Moms Demand Action, Giffords, the Coalition to Stop Gun Violence, we are having a weekend of action this weekend. And we want everyone who cares about this issue to look out. If you go to gunsafetytownhalls.org, one more time, that's gunsafetytownhalls.org. You can see all the events that we are having across the country this weekend. And if you look at that website, it's more than 150 events in all 50 states that we are having across the country. And we want you to get out there, rally, call on your senator to go back to D.C. and vote on these gun violence prevention measures. So please check out that website, gunsafetytownhalls.org, and you can find the event near you where you can rally. The other thing, if you can't make it out to an event, please give a call to Senator Mitch McConnell's office. And you can do that by texting emergency to 877-877. One more time, text emergency to 877-877, and that will connect you directly to Mitch McConnell's office so that you can ask him to call back the Senate and vote on universal background checks, extreme risk laws, which are taking guns out of those who are in moments of crisis, and also an assault weapons ban. And for those of you who are in Virginia, we have a really important week next week, because one thing that you may know is that the Republicans during the special session said, we can't vote on any of these gun bills. What we'll do is send them all to be researched and talked about at the Virginia State Crime Commission. And you may know the Virginia State Crime Commission is meeting this Monday and Tuesday. And there's still a chance for the public to reach back out to the Crime Commission and send in your comments and tell them why gun violence impacts you, why gun violence impacts your community. And the way that you can email the Virginia State Crime Commission is email comments@vscc.virginia.gov. One more time, email comments@vscc.virginia.gov. And those will be public comments that will be put on the record. And we are trying to flood those with people who care about gun violence prevention, who want to see these common sense measures passed. And we have already sent in hundreds of them from across the state. But this weekend's our last chance to do it before the Crime Commission meets. So thank you, everyone who's already done that type of work so far. But we have a lot more to go, not only at the Virginia state level, but at the federal level, too.
So you say that, and you make a really good point. A lot of people are like, well, why would I call Mitch McConnell? Because my phone call doesn't make a difference. But Kevin, as you well know, everyone, every office, every legislator in Richmond keeps track of every single phone call, every single email, every single visit, every single letter. And they actually have a software platform that logs what issues are being addressed and whether the person contacting that legislator is a constituent. So, you know, people may think, well, my email won't mean anything. But if your email is one of 300 emails to your house of your delegate, that is significant.
This is a critical point you're making. I was able to catch an interview with ex-Governor Kasich of Ohio, and the subject was gun violence, and he was not able to get the bills that he wanted to get passed, which were the bills we're talking about, an extreme risk protection order and a universal background check bill. And he said that the reason was we didn't turn out. He said the other side is single-minded. They turn out, and they're one-issue voters in some cases, and we need to send those emails. We need to make those phone calls. We need to contact the Virginia State Commission, that's Crime Commission, that's looking into these bills, because you know that there will be a huge pile and stack from the other side, and we need to do our due diligence and our homework to balance that out and let them know that this is important. This is important.
I think you're absolutely right. I remember talking to a legislator from Southwest Virginia many years ago about marriage equality. And he looked at me, he goes, you know, the people in my district don't contact me about that. He goes, the people in my district contact me about guns. He says, I think you'll eventually get marriage equality without me. He goes, I think it's going to happen. But he said, my constituents care about their guns. And that was a real aha moment for me about the power of people who call, who write, who email, who protest, who show up. That is what makes the difference.
Can I have 10 more seconds?
Sure.
We haven't brought up church. And by church, I mean you've got a pastor, you've got a rabbi, you've got an imam. You need to be with those people and get them on board. They've got a pulpit. They give homilies. You need to get them on board on this subject of prevention of gun violence. So if you're a church-going individual, get with your leadership team at your synagogue, your mosque, your church, your house of worship, and bring up the subject of preventing gun violence.
That is a fantastic final thought, Kevin. Thank you, JP. Thank you, Kevin. Let's pay attention. We've got a recess rally coming up this weekend. You've got websites to go to. You've got comments to make. And this is how you, too, can make change in your community. Join us next Thursday at 9 p.m.